Hi, I'm Steve Sable, and welcome to Volume 5 of our Greatest Ever series, Greatest Ever Runners. Now, it's been said that great running backs aren't made, they're born. And I agree with that. I mean, how else can you explain the moves, the jukes, and the feints? Well, it's simple, really. Following your blockers makes a good running back, but following your instincts makes a great one. Whether it's the bone-jarring runs of Bronco Nagurski or the jaw-dropping moves of Barry Sanders, the truly great runners not only hold the key to the game, they hold the key to our imagination.
Most running backs are born, and running back is special because you need speed, the balance, power, quickness, and intelligence. So it's probably the premier position in football, although most people think that the quarterback is the premier player. I think the running back, if he's a dominating player, will be the most important player in football.
I think the good running backs are able to create things and make things happen. A good running back has the ability to make a person think that they're doing something when they're actually going to do something else.
You don't go out on the practice field and practice those moves. You know, you feel those moves within yourself. You know, you feel people around you, and you make a move. But as far as trying to teach it on the practice field, no, it can't be taught. It's a God-given instinct.
If you're a running back, you know, they pile up on you. They step on your hand when you get up. You know, they do a lot of little things to you. I guess to throw you off the game, you know, if you accept it that way. But I always have a smile on my face, but I know I'm going to get a shot at them one way or another.
I would stay back and let them come to me. I'd go out there to them. Before they get that momentum up to run over me, I'd bring it back to you. And if I brought it back to you, when I start over that next time, you'd be willing to get some help or something.
Just doing what you have to play on the kind of plane that we played on taxes your body terrifically. It was a matter of how much can you do and how much pressure can you live under. How many times can you live up to what not only what's expected of you, but take a step further.
You got to have a heart. No one can measure your heart that had guts to, you know, to get up off the ground and brush yourself off, get back in the huddle, and run the next play just as tough, as harder, and stronger than you ran the play before.
In the early years of professional football, the game's first heroes were runners who played for small-town teams on glorified cow pastures. The most famous was Canton Bulldogs halfback Jim Thorpe, a former Olympian and big league baseball player who dazzled fans with his broken field touchdowns and flair for crowd-pleasing showmanship.
Thorpe was quite an attraction. Before the game, he would go out to the 50-yard line. He would stand on the 50-yard line and drop kick that ball and kick it over the goal line, goal post, practically every time. Then he would turn around and do the opposite goal post.
Thorpe's fame was soon eclipsed by the galloping ghost, Chicago Bears halfback Red Grange, the first football star to single-handedly fill big city stadiums to capacity. Grange routinely commanded in excess of $100,000 a season in an era when $5,000 was considered a generous salary. The Depression days of the 1930s were brightened by Boston's Cliff Battles, a Phi Beta Kappa keyholder who chalked up the first 200-yard game in NFL history. Cliff was also the first back to win two league rushing titles. Battles left the game when he realized he could make a better living outside of football.
Money was also the issue when Bears owner George Halas balked at shelling out big dollars to Bronco Nagurski, the man who defined the fullback position in the NFL. Despite leading the Bears to 8 winning seasons and 2 world championships, Bronco couldn't get Papa Bear to budge.
I understand it was depressed years and that, but I thought I should be getting a little raise, and Halas and I couldn't get together on that. He had different thoughts, and so I retired because I didn't have to depend on football for a living, but I loved to play it, and I liked to have kept on playing.
By the time Nagurski appeared in his final game, a new star was emerging in Philadelphia. Honduras native Steve Van Buren overcame the death of both parents and the wiry frame to blossom into the finest player of the post-war era.
Van Buren in that period, in the 40s, was the best running halfback in pro football. Not only running halfback, he was a great blocker, great receiver, and he was also a real good defense player. He was an exceptional athlete. At 215 pounds, I've seen him run out at Franklin Field. On the track, I've seen him run 9.5, 9.6. He was a rare athlete. He's a type of player that comes along maybe once every generation.
Steve was at his best when the stakes were highest, scoring the only touchdown in the 1948 title game. A year later, in a torrential downpour, Van Buren ripped through the Rams for 196 yards. A postseason record that stood for more than 30 years.
They forgot about me. In fact, they said they weren't worried about me anymore, but they were going to worry about the other halfback. They stopped him, but they didn't stop me.
All told, Steve led the Eagles to 3 title appearances and a pair of championships, while becoming the first man ever to win 4 rushing crowns. Even today, many historians insist that no back was more dominant in his time than Steve Van Buren. ...240-pound fullback Marion Motley filled up the entire frame of a TV picture tube and knocked down any opponent who got in his way.
Well, I was a hard runner, very hard runner. I figured if I ran over you one time, I didn't have to run over you a second time. Sometimes I would jump through the line, but I know this guy was going to catch me. So what I'd do, I'd turn right back and run it back into him. The next time I'd jump out there, if I faked that way, he'd freeze, and I could go on down.
Marion led the Browns to 5 championships and still holds the record for the highest rushing average in a single game, better than 17 yards per carry. The Mammoth Motley was a team all by himself, but opponents faced an even bigger mismatch, trying to shackle San Francisco's million-dollar backfield, which consisted of 4 future Hall of Famers.
If either one of us were to touch the ball, we figured we could score from anywhere on the field. I think we complemented each other because no one could set their bearings on one person in particular because they never knew where we were going to hit them from.
My type of running was quick moves that I just didn't see. If I escaped someone, it was a quick move to the left or to the right. It wasn't the weave and flowing type of a run.
John Henry was a great football player that could play both ways, and at times he did play both ways for us. He was one heck of a runner, a slicing type runner, knees, elbows, and everything else coming at you at the same time. And if you were standing there in the way, John Henry would hit you. And that's just the only way you can phrase it. John Henry had no fear of man, beast, or whatever. Even now, I think Michael Henry is one of the greatest open field runners that you'll ever see. He had a style, to me, that was flowing like a will-o'-the-wisp, and it seemed like at times he had eyes in the back of his head. It was just God's gift the way he ran, and it was just poetry in motion. I think we had one of the greatest offensive machines that was ever created. If we had had the defense to go along with it, I don't think anyone could have beaten us.
The Niners' backfield remains the single most talented in league history.
But another 1950s runner named Ollie Mattson was so gifted that the Rams had to trade 9 players just to acquire his contract from the Chicago Cardinals.
The greatest back that I ever saw was Ollie Mattson. In game films, well, you could actually see where Ollie would have a halfback come over at an angle trying to run him down. And the halfback would get maybe 2 or 3 steps away, and all of a sudden, Ollie would shift gears and go full blast. And in the game film, it would actually look like the defensive back had stopped, had just stopped running because Mattson just took off so fast.
I think that my skills and my talent will stack up against the best. I could be going down the sideline, the opening, and the guys would be reaching. Acceleration, that's one thing that people don't really realize, you know. You can accelerate so fast, and the guy think he's got you, and he's just grabbing air. It means a lot to you when you do have the speed and know what to do with it. Now you see me, and now you don't.
Despite his talents, Mattson toiled primarily for losing teams. But Lenny Moore's running and receiving skills helped make the Baltimore Colts a TV ratings attraction and a perennial NFL powerhouse.
He was my inspiration. He was an idol almost to me because I used to look forward to going to practice to watch him run. He was so smooth. He could lay his feet down and walk on eggs without breaking them. And he would stop on a dime. He would set the blocker up for you.
To me, it came easy. I didn't have to think about what I had to do in a game under game situations. It just happened. If you were to ask me, well, Lenny, how did you do that? I can't explain to you how I did, because I don't know how I did it. I know what the play is, I know where I'm supposed to go, and other than that, things happen.
What happened was touchdowns, and Lenny still holds the record for scoring in 18 consecutive games. Perhaps no other athlete was as tailor-made for football's growing television appeal than Lenny Moore. The 1960s ushered in the brand new American Football League, characterized by the high-octane offense of Coach Sid Gilman's San Diego Chargers. Sid's feature back was Paul Lowe, a former college hurdler who played the game with boyish exuberance.
We had fun. It was a kid. We still treat it as a kid's game, and we feel like we're just out playing, like in a playground. You know, that's what it meant to us, just going out having fun.
Paul Lowe had amazing escapability in his prime. I remember him running toward the right, the end sweep, getting stopped. I remember him reversing his field, coming back the opposite way, Sid yelling, no, 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 no. And Paul is going down the sideline, and Sid starts yelling, yes, yes. And I know what he's thinking, just the way I designed it.
Lowe finished second only to the Raiders' Clem Daniels, a converted defensive back who became the leading rusher in AFL history. As effective as he was on the ground, Clem was even more explosive through the air, becoming one of the first pro runners ever to be utilized in his team's deep passing game.
So one thing about Clem Daniels, he had great hands. He was more dangerous coming out of the backfield catching a swing pass than he was running with the ball. And that's what we feared, because in those days when you play the 4-3 defense and I happen to be the weak side linebacker, you would have to cover him. And he scared the hell out of me.
AFL stars like Daniels paved the way for more wide open offenses. But the 60s were dominated by the ground-oriented Green Bay Packers. Leading the charge was Jim Taylor, whose take-no-prisoners attitude left terrorized tacklers running for cover.
He liked to hit people. He's got a body that was built for hitting people. You know, there'd be a nice hole here. He'd rather bounce off of this guy and then hit the hole. You know, he liked to punish people.
No, that's incorrect. I didn't go out of my way to hit people. They would find me and hit me. But I did have a strong desire to pick up that extra 2 foot or every possible inch in each individual run.
It's combat
and you have to know that you're going to be subjected to pain or to suffering. So it's a matter of accepting all of this up front.
Taylor was the only ball carrier to snap the otherwise uninterrupted string of annual rushing titles collected by Cleveland's superhuman Jim Brown.
Jim Brown always had the same demeanor. He warmed up by himself, not with the rest of the team. And we sort of stood with our hands on our hips watching him warm up. It was almost like Superman or Captain Marvel or somebody being on the field with him.
Indestructible, unstoppable, the opposition totally feared his ability to run the football. Because if we got one or two blockers ahead of him, he'd probably run all the way from Cleveland to Schenectady, New York. But he could do that alone anyway.
One time I had Jim Brown coming running right at me. This time, I mean, I could see in his eyes he wasn't going to run around me. I got squared off in a great football position, and I let him have it as hard as I could. And when I woke up, my helmet was bent all the way over my face mask, and it was turned sideways, and my nose was bleeding. And I think his record sort of speaks for itself. He only played 9 years, and several of those years were in 12-game seasons, whereas now we're playing 16 games, and it makes a lot of difference.
Football was an opportunity to compete against the best, make some money, and learn about myself. There was a tremendous satisfaction and a challenge because now I knew I had the equipment to be a top gun, and all of these people were finding ways to stop me. And I knew that I had to be as tough, as strong, as mental as them because they were looking at every weakness I had. So I tried to be true to myself and learn about myself and live up to certain standards. The only person that I wanted to satisfy was me.
Every play he ran, you only saw it once. If we had the capabilities today to show him from 15 different angles, people would say that was not a human.
I'd call Jim Brown still today with all that I have seen in the plus 40 years association with the NFL, the best athlete I've ever seen, and certainly the best football player I've ever seen.
Nobody before or since has run the football with the fluid grace of Gale Sayers. Gale scored a record 22 touchdowns in his rookie season with Chicago, but he might have weaved his magic in Kansas City had not the Bears emptied out their team vault.
We did draft Gale, and Lamar Hunt also drafted him. Well, I knew Lamar had something like $500 or $600 million, and I was concerned whether he'd use that dough to get Gale Sayers. I was very much concerned about it. Then I saw game film of Gale in action, and I never saw such moves in my life. And I made up my mind right then and there. Lamar Hunt and all his dough won't mean a thing. I'm going to get Gale Sayers.
The five-time All-Pro won a pair of league rushing titles by utilizing a highly developed runner's ESP that kept him out of danger.
Besides the vision, there's a feel too. You know, I can't see directly in back of me, but I can see on the side of me, and I can feel people. That's all God-given instinct. You know, you can't practice on that. It's no way you can practice on that. You just gotta have it, and the man upstairs gives it to you.
Gale was the youngest man ever inducted into the Hall of Fame. He was eventually joined by Buffalo's O.J. Simpson, who credited an innovative addition to the Bills' playbook for his ground-gaining success.
There's one play that came in a few years later. We ran it, we called it 26. It looks like a dive, and then, you know, you run out of the eye. And I remember in practice telling Jim Ringo, our offensive line coach, that the play can't work. It's taking me too long to get to the point of attack. But the first time we ran the play, I must have gone 88 yards for a touchdown. that play became a real big play for us. I think I may have scored 4 or 5 times on that play years later, over 40, 50-yard runs, you know, from that play alone.
Even Pittsburgh's Steel Curtain, one of the toughest defenses in football history, couldn't bottle up the juice.
We had him inside their 10-yard line. Went into a goal line defense. He broke through that first wave, and he was gone. Nobody could catch him. He was a great, great player.
Simpson became the first back to gain 2,000 yards in a season. But a star in Minnesota named Chuck Foreman annually approached the same output as both a runner and receiver. Foreman's graceful pirouettes transformed a stodgy, predictable Vikings attack into one of the league's flashiest. And his all-purpose skills led them to 3 Super Bowl appearances during the 1970s.
I remember he did a lot of twisting. He'd do those full turns on a dime and come back. He'd go to make a cut. Instead of a direct cut, he might spin all the way around.
Foreman also turned the heads of his coaches, who seized the opportunity to add a new wrinkle to NFL offenses.
I think Chuck Foreman was responsible for changing a concept in football. I think a lot of people realize, because of a back like Chuck Foreman, that you can build an offense on these dump-off passes if you have a guy skilled enough to beat that first tackle. Chuck Foreman, with all those spins of his, he could make something out of nothing. I think a lot of people changed their drafting philosophy and went to a back who was possibly a better receiver than a runner because of that Chuck Foreman type of skill.
In Dallas, Tony Dorsett was strictly a ball carrier, but it was a task he performed better than nearly anyone who preceded him. When the former Heisman Trophy winner finally retired from the pros, only one other back in history had rushed for more yardage. Tony set his sights on greatness and had the vision to achieve it.
If you ever watch me play, you'll see when I get a ball, my eyes, they light up like silver dollars. And I'm just looking at everything, and I do see a lot out there. Running a football is instinctive. It's all creative. It's all impromptu, and things are happening very, very quick. And my vision helped me, I think, survive for 9 years in the NFL.
Dorsett is also the only back who holds the one rushing record that can never be broken.
Goal line defense for the Vikings. A handoff, Dorsett at the middle. Here he goes. Cuts to his right.
Going all the way.
Here they go. To the 30. To the 40. He's got 2 men to beat. To the 40. To the 30. To the 20. To the 10. The 5. Touchdown. In the record books, 99 yards.
When you look back on it and see Tony Dorsett's name at the top of every running list that was ever compiled, you'll realize how great a running back he really was.
He's going to score it! Tony Dorsett on the touchdown!
The Miami Dolphins dynasty of the 1970s was built on punishing ball control, and no back dominated his turf more ferociously than Larry Zonka.
Zonka was probably the toughest fullback to ever play the game. He was an emotional type on the field. He would take the blows and shake them off, and guys would really try to punish him too, but he did most of the punishing. He's the only running back I've ever seen get a penalty by while running the football. Without physical offensive line and a physical fullback like Zonk, we did wear down a lot of teams. He's just a brutal specimen, big, strong, listed at 239, but probably on game day weighed 250 to 255. And he was just a big, tough individual.
I lived a very violent life in the NFL, and I liked it that way. It was great. I had great people around me to help support that style. But the thing they remember is being affiliated with a team that not only went to the Super Bowl several years in a row, but went once and was undefeated.
Zonka was a crucial element in 2 world championships, but the Pittsburgh Steelers doubled that output in the 70s after the arrival of Franco Harris.
Franco really showed us that we could win, because before Franco,
we did not win. In the big game, there was no one better than Franco. No one. I mean, he lived for them.
Whether it was his astonishing immaculate reception or MVP honors in Super Bowl IX, Harris raised his already lofty regular season standards to even higher ground in the playoffs.
What makes things special? Is every day the same? Is every day Christmas? Is every day Easter? No, it's not. So when someone tells me that the middle of the season, regular season game is the same as the championship game, not to me it isn't.
Franco carried the ball more times for more yardage and more touchdowns than any player in postseason history. But while Harris made playoff appearances a regular habit, it seemed highly unlikely that Jets fullback John Riggins would ever be in the national spotlight for anything else other than his eccentric grooming preferences.
I had always wanted to have a mohawk when I was a kid, but my folks wouldn't let me. And I finally donned him and said, well, gee whiz, I'm growing up now. I can have one if I want one. So I did it.
Riggins looked the part of a Native American, but continued to battle for the losing side until he switched tribes and became part of the Washington Redskins. The exotic haircuts vanished as Riggo transformed himself into a human battering ram.
John Riggins used to deliver lumber. Nobody hit John. John hit people.
Riggins set new league records for touchdowns, saving the biggest score for the most important game of his life.
Crank up that diesel. Let's go, diesel.
There's the snap, hand to Riggins. Good hole. He's got the first down to the 40. He's gone.
Riggins left the NFL with over 100 touchdowns and a Super Bowl ring. While down in Houston, another power back named Earl Campbell accumulated statistics of a different kind. Nobody left more black and blue defenders scattered like rubble than the Texas Terror, known as the Tyler Rose.
You just could not tackle him with a hand or an arm now. You can forget that. In fact, you couldn't tackle him with a shoulder a lot of times, unless you had two or three sets of shoulders. He'd break into the open, he'd look somebody up to run over rather than look somebody up to dodge. Hell, I don't believe he ever finished a mile run, but I've never seen a football field a mile long, so it didn't bother me. On fourth and a mile, we weren't going to give him the ball.
I knew what was going to happen, and they knew what was going to happen. And they knew that if it wasn't like six of them, or four or five maybe, he's going to go because he ain't going to quit. Kind of girlish for one guy to tackle me. I mean, I wanted to have a bunch of them.
Earl's reckless style was bound to take its toll, and it eventually did. He played only 8 seasons before his body finally gave out. But in his time, there was no player more beloved by Oiler fans or more feared by opponents than Earl Campbell. If ever there was a halfback made in heaven, it was Walter Payton.
I have often said probably the best running back combination ever in the league would be Walter Payton and any other back.
Payton was not the swiftest, the strongest, or most elusive of runners, but his drive to excel and total disdain for failure made him the most prolific ball carrier the NFL has ever seen.
Everybody looks at this physical quality or that physical quality and forget about the heart. And the heart's what makes a great one. Walter Payton, he's too short in my butt. I mean, he got the heart.
Payton's powerful legs churned out the yardage, finishing runs in style with his patented show pony strut. But Walter wielded his muscular arms for a decidedly different purpose.
I used the straight arm for several reasons. I didn't have that breakaway speed like a lot of the other players had, and I utilized the stiff arm to even things out, because someone, they just couldn't run up and lay a hit on you. They had to, once they got closer, they had to start thinking about other things. What is he going to do? If he's going to attack me, use a stiff arm, or slow down, or what?
Peyton could dish out the body blows better than any back, but he gained league-wide respect for his ability to absorb punishment in equal measure.
I can remember a time he had a terrible knee up in Minnesota, and Fred Cato, who was our trainer, said there's no way he can play. He gained 175 yards with a knee that nobody else would have dressed with. And the day he set the single game rushing mark, he had the flu so bad he was throwing up and had a fever, and he ran for 275 yards. What makes a great player? The ability to endure, to be there when you feel like being there, and to be there when you don't feel like it. And Walter endured. He was there for 13 years.
Right behind Peyton on the all-time rushing list is Eric Dickerson, whose gliding gallop fooled some who believed he wasn't operating in top gear.
People used to say that I didn't look that fast and I wasn't running hard, but I ran track and my strides were so long and I guess easy, because when I came to the Rams, John Robinson said, Eric, come here. I said, yes? You have to run full speed. I said, coach, I am running full speed. I said, I tell you what, get out here and try to catch me. So I went after my first big run that I had, I guess the Jets, 85-yard run. He said, you were running full speed that day.
Out to the 30, 35 to the 40, to the 45, to the 50, down to the 35, down to the 25, down to the 10, 5, touchdown, Eric Dickerson, 85 yards.
As a rookie, Dickerson led the NFL in rushing. Then, in only his second season, Eric shattered what was considered one of football's most unassailable records.
The next year, coming in, I said I'd get 2,000 yards. I knew I would. At that time, I just felt like it was so simple.
Eric's 2,105 yards is now the annual target for NFL running backs.
He's got it, and a brand new single-season rushing record for the outstanding star from Southern Methodist.
While Dickerson was setting standards in Los Angeles, San Francisco counterpart Roger Craig was becoming the first back in history to gain 1,000 yards running and receiving in the same season.
You have your great runners like the Dickersons, you had your Dorsets and players like that, but you know they weren't the type of runners that could catch the ball and do something with it. And I think the game has changed tremendously over the years, that you have to be an all-purpose back to survive in this league. My biggest asset as a runner is I try to change up. You know, I be aggressive one time, and then another time I might just be a finesser, you know, as far as faking them out or not giving them a clean shot. I think you have to change up a little bit. You just can't just be just one style runner. I mean, you have to be able to, you know, mix it up a little bit, just like a boxer. I use my knees instead of my fist.
The draw up the middle to Craig, and he breaks loose and runs loose. He gets used to the 30, to the 25. He's down to the 20. Breaks loose again. Into the 10. 5. Touchdown, 49ers. Oh, what a spectacular run by Roger Craig.
Craig collected 3 Super Bowl rings to go with his yardage. But the Cardinals' Otis Anderson wasn't as lucky. OJ had to be content with a string of 1,000-yard campaigns and very little else.
I was on a losing man mentality. I never won anything, because when I was a Cardinal, we would be winning a lot of games, but came down the third, fourth quarter, somehow, some way, we lost. So I never knew what to expect. I just said every game that they was winning, I just knew they were going to lose.
But Anderson's fortunes changed after he was traded to the Giants. When injury struck, the 33-year-old warhorse proved there was still plenty of bounce in his step.
13-10 left, give to O.J. Anderson. Swings the right hand side, breaks the tackle across the 30, 25. He's on his horse to the 10, 5, fights his way in for the touchdown.
Hey,
nobody. I showed speed.
I could have made 20.
I got smart.
I could have made 20.
Years of defeat were wiped away in one glorious night when O.J. Anderson took center stage.
here is my fantasy, my dream, the place I always wanted to be was in a Super Bowl. And I always wanted to be the featured player, but, you know, I was there, and I felt like I backdoored my way in there. But some of the Giants players, they said, you earned the right, man, for all those years in St. Louis.
That's on the 1.5-yard line. OJ, touchdown!
It had taken him 11 years, but Anderson finally had his championship ring, along with Super Bowl MVP honors. Marcus Allen was fortunate enough to earn both in only his second season.
Rocket giving to Allen, sending him wide left. He has to reverse his field, but he gets away for a moment. Comes back up to the 30, 25, 40. The Raiders catch him. Let's go to the 50, down to the 40. Into the marker, to the 20, to the 10, to the 5. Touchdown, Raiders! Oh, Raiders!
That was the one time that I remember being in a zone, if you can remember such a thing. I mean, everything was going absolutely right. I mean, the visualization of holes, things were moving in slow motion, and I felt that I was, at least they were moving in slow motion, and I felt that I was at top speed at all time. It was really a strange thing, but a wonderful thing, and I got it at the right time, and that was at the Super Bowl.
Well into the next decade, Allen continued to set records and score touchdowns. First with the Raiders, then with the Kansas City Chiefs.
Handoff, sweep right side, Marcus Bigel, 30, 25, cuts inside, got a block, 20, cuts across the other way, 15, 10, foot race to the 5, running to the far sideline, he's got in a touchdown!
Let's go, our best play with our best player.
What do you think we call?
Everybody in this place knows. They know.
On third down and goal to go, Marcus Allen darts over for the touchdown for Kansas City. His 100th career rushing touchdown. And in the snow, the legends of Walter Payton, John Riggins, and Jim Brown wait for him. The only four men in the history of the National Football League to have 100 rushing touchdowns.
Resolve, the power to persevere when lesser men would be daunted. It's an attribute Thurman Thomas has always had. Take Super Bowl 25, for example. Thomas could easily have won the MVP trophy, but when the Bills lost the game, he lost the hardware. Rather than make it his focus, he made it a footnote. For Thomas, thriving requires as much temperament as talent.
Everybody waiting for it to fall? We may fall a little bit every now and then, but we always know one thing, we're going to get right back up.
He has, in my mind, the single most important quality of a great running back, and that is balance. He can be hit, and you don't topple him, you move him to the side. Because of his great balance, he has the ability to cut. He has great discretion, when to turn it on, when to go outside, when to cut it back, when to lunge forward. Beyond that, and this is quite a bonus for us, he's a magnificent receiver as a running back. We didn't know he was that good a receiver. Coming out of college, he rarely caught a ball.
You have a lot of running backs who can just run the football, and that's just about all they can do. I like to expand my game, and expanding my game is blocking or when I have to pick up blitz and also pass receiving. Not the little 5-yard passes, the 10-yard passes, but also the passes downfield 25 and 30 yards.
7 consecutive years with 1,000 yards rushing and a record 4 straight seasons leading the league in yards from scrimmage are proof of Thurman's versatility. Thomas is a jack of all trades, but the undisputed king of contortions is Barry Sanders.
The first thing you do when they hand them the ball is you stop breathing and your eyes get real big and you watch. And you sit, move closer to the TV or to the edge of your seat in the stadium, and you just wait for something great to happen.
It might be a 6-yard run, it might be a 60-yard run, but it's going to take your breath away from it.
And bumps to the 40, breaks it, 35, 30, he's gone! Unbelievable! Oh my gosh, what a run!
You can't say they got him.
Like it was bottled up for nothing.
Because, you know, until the whistle blows, they don't got him.
I thought he was down.
I did too!
Rodney P. draw to Barry. Barry skirts to the 15, looks for running room, cuts to the 10. He's to the 5, and will take it in. Touchdown, Lions. Oh, that is one of the great runs you'll ever see.
Trying to tackle Barry is a frustrating and futile pursuit, like whispering in the wind. And perhaps that's how best to describe him, like the wind. For he moves as if propelled by forces beyond man's control. With the sudden swirling power of a winter gale or the ethereal touch of a summer breeze, Sanders' ability has an elemental quality hard to articulate, but easy to appreciate.
When you look at Barry Sanders on the football and you see him do the amazing thing, run after run, sometimes you just gotta look to the heavens and say, wow.
Barry Sanders with a move that Mikhail Baryshnikov couldn't make.
There are some times when he'll get the ball and can literally not get touched. He's doing this against the best in the world. How can someone be that much better than everybody else?
I wasn't terribly attracted to soccer or getting involved in some band, you know, or being an actor, a race car driver, you know. I don't know. I've always liked ball. Being able to go out and compete, being healthy and young and having the physical ability to go out and do really well at something that I really like doing is something that is really fulfilling for me.
Sanders' unassuming ego and unabashed ability make him at ease anywhere. But today's most accomplished runner is only comfortable when he's in the zone. Fortunately for Cowboy fans, that zone is a movable feast.
Smith coming right, trying to outrun the coverage, makes a cut, gets it. Oh, he's still going. Oh, he's going to score.
Oh, this is incredible.
I've been asked so many times about, you know, what makes Emmitt special. You've heard people talk about his great leg strength or how he makes people miss and how he's able to break tackles and how he makes long runs even though he doesn't have great speed. The biggest thing is he got just such tremendous pride. I mean, he has pride that he wants to be the very, very best. And that's what drives him, and that's what gives him the determination during a ball game. He's a great player and the best running back I've ever seen in my life.
I feel that he gets better not only as the game goes on. He runs stronger in the fourth quarter than he does in the first quarter. I think he runs harder at the end of the season than he does in the beginning of the season. And maybe this is a trend where as his career progresses from year to year, he's getting better as his career gets longer. So I think he's just one of those unique athletes that seems to thrive and to get better as things progress.
4 rushing titles in 5 consecutive years with more than 1,400 yards rushing are impressive enough. But it's Emmitt's ability to follow not just his blockers, but his instincts that make him the game's most valuable runner.
I think in the third and fourth quarter, when I am doing some of my best running, I feel like instincts start to take over.
Those instincts are sharpest in the clutch, at the goal line.
When you're down that close, you work so hard to travel the length of the field, and you must reward not only yourself but the team by hopefully punching that ball in the end zone. And, you know, when you get down that close, all you have to do is make one or two people miss, and the rest of it is actually momentum and power that's going to get you into the end zone.
In 1995, such power propelled Smith to the end zone a record 25 times.
To the one, touchdown Emmitt Smith, Hello record. The 25th rushing touchdown of the year for Emmitt Smith.
Everybody's talking about him not having great speed or great size and all that stuff, but yet no one ever seems to catch him from behind. He's always outrunning people to the end zone.
Emmitt Smith taking it all the way. Got a seam, got the lane, got 68 yards. This one's over.
I don't really try to go out each week. Well, I'm going to run like Tony Dorsett today. Tomorrow I'm going to run like Walter Payton. The next day I'm going to run like O.J. Simpson. And then 2 weeks from now I'm going to run like Jim Brown. No, it's not like that. I try to go out and do what God has given me the ability to do and do it to the best of my ability.
If the true test of greatness is performance when it matters most, Smith Super Bowl credentials remain impeccable. 3 championships, 5 touchdowns, and an MVP award. It's a resume worthy of all-time status.
I honestly feel like I'm destined to do something major in the NFL. I just feel like that. I don't know why I feel like that, but I feel like God has definitely put down a path for me, and I'm trying to follow that path close as possible. I think when you talk about running backs, you got to talk about all the great running backs, all the way down from Red Grange down to Earl Campbell. I mean, from Walter on down. I am in a fraternity of running backs. The game itself hasn't changed. And I believe the running backs 10, 15, 20 years ago can come step right in and do things that we're doing now. But a kinship to the great ones, they're great for a reason. And I continue to aspire to be like them or be as good as they were. And that's what I'm striving for right now.